other co-curators, David Dower, who's there, Rob Orchard, Mark Russell, who's not here yet from Under the Radar, and Mayan Wang, who's also not here yet from Under the Radar. We hope this is going to be just one of many events that you attend through the course of the week. We started the TNT Festival with Mike Daisy last weekend, and a number of films, and it's a week, 10 days of workshops like this about process and how work gets made, films that interact with this kind of process and how work get made, and then performances. And there's music. Am I missing something? Music, did I get them all?
No, it's just that our other curators on this part of it are the New England Foundation.
And New England, yes, I was headed there. New England Foundation for the Arts worked with us to put these workshops together, and we're extremely grateful. And then to note that we usually try to make what we do at HowlRound, which is where I work, we try to make everything accessible to as many people as possible all the time, so we are live streaming this on New Play TV, so you can either watch it with us, or you could watch it later in archive form, but everybody can get access who can't actually be physically present in Boston. So. The way it's going to work today, I'm going to introduce our first group of a couple of artists. They're going to do what they do for about 45 minutes. Then I'm going to introduce our second couple of artists, and they're going to do what they do for 45 minutes. And then we're going to leave 20 or so minutes for questions from the audience. And so I'm ready to kick us off. So I have Nick Slie, who's co-artistic director of Mondo Bizarro, and I have Jeff Becker, and I didn't get an official title, but from ArtSpot Productions. They regularly work together. They're working together on this new project, and they're going to share some process, and everybody gave me a sentence that they wanted articulated about themselves. They are fascinated with creating large-scale projects that reflect a sincere blend of disciplines and deeply engage the community where they take place. So have at
it. Hello. How y'all doing?
Good.
You're not going to be sitting for long, but I'm Nick, this is Jeff. We're always amazed at the HowlRound people. Y'all are awesome, so thank you for doing what you're doing, and we're really honored to be here. We're here because the New England Foundation for the Arts has made this opportunity, so we're grateful for that as well. We are going to share a little bit of our process with you today in a project that is called Cry You One. It's a new performance project. It's being co-created by Mondo Bizarro and ArtSpot Productions in Southeast Louisiana on land that is pretty rapidly disappearing. So we want to share with you a little bit of how we create work today, and we want to do so by illustrating that. And then we want to talk to you a little bit and show you some images about the work we've been doing. And then we just want to open the space for questions, and then we'll jump into the debate society. So just really briefly, ArtSpot Productions and Mondo Bizarro are two companies who make ensemble theater, or devised theater. We work in a way that some of you are probably very familiar with, which about a 12 to 18 month gestation period. We go into rooms together where all of the people that make the work are present, the designers, the musicians, the performers, the actors. We usually have some central theme or concept, and we go exploring. And I like to think of it as the process is very similar to that of which how nature works. You think about the ways in which plants and flowers seed, right? And they just release seeds and seeds and seeds, and how many seeds are released before one of those plants takes, right? So we make and make and make and throw away and throw away and throw away and make and make and make. And then when something lands, we usually move pretty swiftly towards it. Right now, we're in the process of having left a performance that is really cooking. And it was a very hard thing. Friday's rehearsal was amazing, and Monday's rehearsal was amazing, and we feel like we're right at the edge of a story, and Jeff and I left. So it was a real, we believe that we're continuing the work, but our colleagues are at home right amidst just about to find what we feel like is the seed of what's gonna become our work. So to start, Jeff's gonna lead you through a little exercise. It's not a bondage workshop today. I know when you saw the rope, you were thinking, and I'm sorry. But I do think for earned income, we should really start to consider bondage and those types of workshops. Jeff's gonna lead you through the rope exercise, and we're gonna talk to you from here. So
something just to add about our work is that we predominantly work outdoors. We do site-specific or environmental responsive work, and sometimes we do shows that are inside, but we generally like to work outside, so we work in the rehearsal room, but we also work in the space outside, and the visual world kind of comes in at the same time as, say, any kind of text, so it's all kind of has equal weight, and I like to look at it as kind of a visual dramaturgy that helps steer the show. So we're going to kind of show you kind of some of the things that we do, some of the work, but instead of talking about it, I want to do something. So could you all stand up, and I would like you all to come and take one piece of rope, please.
I thought he said it wasn't bonded.
Once you've got your rope, I want you to form two lines facing each other along the space. Try the equal lines. Yeah, this the space is a little small, but I think we can do this. We don't have to go up the aisle. Let's try to even out the sides. Might have to actually go out this way a little bit. I'm going to move you all down all the way to here, just so we have room.
Out the hall, yeah.
Yeah, just come down this way.
It's gonna work.
Yeah, those pictures.
The river
is pretty. Okay, so now what I want you to do is to take your rope and hold it in your right hand and let the bottom dangle. Okay. Now I want you to take your left hand and take the free end of the rope next to you. Okay.
You flinched.
Got it. You might even need to move down a little bit more. We'll see. When you hold the side, when you do this. Okay. So what I want you to do with your rope is I want you to make a river.
Make a what?
So make a river. So each side of you is a bank. Now you're going to lay it down onto the floor.
Oh, that's good.
You want to lay this down on the floor. You want to connect it as a river. You can be as close. I mean, think of rivers having a source and a mouth. Okay. You want to connect all the sides. You don't want the water leaking out. So take your time.
Oh, we should knock it.
Right. If you need to go out in the hallway, just go for it.
Are we getting it?
Yeah.
Do whatever you need to do to make the river. But you don't want it leaking. Not yet.
Are you sure?
So guys, from wherever you are in the space right now, we want you just to consider one thing. Looking at your little section of rope, which is your little piece of river that you're responsible for, just think for a minute about a river you know, a body of water you know. Some of you grew up in the desert, think about a river that you visited. But a river you know, or a body of water that you are familiar with, that you've been on. And I want you to think about the experiences or the experience you have of that body of water. Take a second just to reflect on that. And then turning to the person on your left. So how will we do it? Just turn to the person, yeah. How will we do that? Turn to the person nearest you and just find a pair. Find somebody, pick someone.
It could be three as well.
It could be three as well if you need to. And just for about 2 minutes, guys, briefly share the first impression that came of the experience of the river that you just thought of in your head. Briefly share with your neighbor really quick here.
So when I was little, I'd always be like picking blackberries and falling into rivers.
Oh my god.
So that's my river.
I do a lot of blueberry picking.
No way.
Yeah.
Really? Really? Yeah. I wanted to put a Yellowstone my whole life, just a small, giant one.
But did I just get that wrong? That's just like,
no, there's guys who say there's green guys, and it's kind of like the no, I grew up in the Bay Area, but Yosemite was sort of like, my parents are Russians, so that's how they go to see that. So I was like,
oh, cool.
Yeah.
You had to work on
their own sonic.
Oh, awesome. Very cool. We had a sonic growing up.
No way. How big is it?
How big is it?
Well, like,
all right, guys. So, if you can just listen to Jeff.
Okay, so now what we want to do is we are going to flood this river, okay? And it's a slow flood. It's not a fast flood. It's going to be really, really slow. So, Nick is going to play the violin. And when you hear the violin start, I want you to do what you need to do to disassemble your river and make it slowly rise and flood, okay? And then when he stops playing the violin, I want you to reform the river again, okay? And reform it slowly. So you're thinking of the water slowly rising, the water slowly receding, okay? So, is that clear? So you're gonna reform the river. We don't have a lot of space, so you know, in a bigger room we could move around more, but here you're just gonna rise and just, I want you to look at how it reforms. Okay, that's clear? Mm-hmm. Go for it. Slowly.
Take a look down that river and see if the river has changed any, and observe if you've had to do anything else. But take a look at the river post-flood. Look at its banks. Look at the way it shifted. Did it get wider or narrower? And take a moment to consider a time when, wherever you live, a natural process, nature, took its course, or nature was in charge. Our nature took over in a way that we were not in control of. Take a minute to think about that. And when you're ready, turn to your same partner and share that story of a time where nature took over in a place where you live.
Pretty regularly the jokes would get out of outside, like maybe somewhere in the house. And it's clear that like if they got out, they would like find their way in. And you like hear them like flopping around in the kitchen.
My friend actually decided to go for a nap, and we went out onto one of the bridges here in Boston, and we were walking out of it, and the wind was so strong, I got blown off, like, the sidewalk.
Really?
And, like, into the street, and I was just like, oh, my God.
That's amazing.
It took me a moment to be like, I am very, okay, wait a minute, I'm not in control right now.
No, it's amazing. Yeah, the hurricane. I'm surprised they didn't take the hurricane immediately. That was like such a big deal.
Right? What was that? Were you in New York City?
I was, yeah. But our my house, my apartment was like just outside of the big flood zone, so like I didn't get hit there. We were doing a show at the time, so we had to cancel a couple shows. It actually worked out okay. It was just like I got the door, and people were like pulling guns at gas stations.
It gets
like death without a police force. It gets like death and guns within days. And if you don't have water, it's like people without water and power. It's like it's so bad. Like we are like, yeah, we are always like 3 days away from like that house.
That's all right. Listen up now. Here's the next challenge here. And you know there are slow floods and there are breaches, which we know a lot about in Louisiana. So this time when Nick plays, he's gonna play at a different tempo, but I want a really fast break apart. And you're gonna break apart, and when we reform the river, we're gonna reform it very quickly. And your challenge is to change its course. Don't just set it down where you were before. Change its course. Okay? Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
All right. That's it. No, move around. Don't be afraid. There you go. Find a spot. You each need to be on one end of your rope and an end on somebody else's rope, okay? Take your time.
I thought you said you had to be fast.
Well, fast as you can, but you still got to form the river. No holes. If there's holes, water comes out. And you're still flooding. Remember, we're making a river, not a lake.
I think you want a river.
It means it's got to go somewhere.
I was into the lake.
Well,
too.
Well,
yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Well,
Around in a circle? Is it like, is it gonna go around?
You're in a circle, but it's gotta have an opening at the end. I mean, it could go underground, of course. But for our river.
I don't know what this does.
Close it up.
That's an eddy.
It's an eddy. It goes across to the other, it can go across to the other side.
Yeah, we're gonna get there.
So look at the river, look how it's reformed. Okay? Interesting.
There are a bunch of engineers over here.
I don't think so.
I like it.
So now, if you look at this, notice how it's reformed. How, when you have less time to reform it, how it's changed, look how it's bigger, look at what it looks like. So now, your last challenge here, you need to make this river straight, a straight line. And I mean straight, like see these lines, straight. Do whatever you need to do. We are not leaving here until it's straight. No curves, nothing, straight. I want to put a laser on it and it needs to be straight. So whatever you need to do, make it straight. If we run out of room, you got to just make it straight.
Yeah.
So.
Sure.
You know what I mean? You know.
We're traveling. We're traveling.
You guys.
Straight.
You're gonna put this on the ground too. Straight.
Yeah.
You know, I took the Corps of Engineers like 70 years to do this. You've got time.
This is good straight. This is not quite as straight.
Yeah.
This wouldn't prevent a flood.
Yeah, it's straight.
Yeah. Sorry. I gotta remember where I am.
I'm in the river.
Getting there.
One more little loop of the angle right here.
Yeah, we gotta get it straighter.
What's happening there? Here.
Pull it tight. Do what you need to do.
Tiny rope.
That's okay. You can do that.
You can
do whatever
you steel
have
rope.
To do.
There's the bend.
There we go.
Engineering. I like this. This is really nice.
This is nice.
We got a little water. It starts with a waterfall.
Excellent.
So guys, this last little part real quick. Take a moment to reflect upon the semi-straightness of your canal. You guys are pretty good engineers. Take a moment to reflect about a time where nature has been manipulated by human, by the built world, where a place where you live, where some natural process has been interrupted, where it's not happening the same as it used to, where water used to flow, or anything as such. And think about that for a second, and when you're ready, share that last little story with your partner about a time where the natural process where you live has been interrupted. If
by
it has been.
By
nature and or by humans, but we're thinking about the built world mainly.
Yeah.
The human built world, where humans have interfered with the natural process. Great question, Eric. Think about that and reflect if you can.
Stepping out of the building, it's really cool. All right, guys, just in the interest of time, since we're going, we're going to have to kind of move a little quicker. Can you listen up for a second?
Huge
pun of
nature that it doesn't get.
So I just want you to note a couple things before we go on, that how difficult it is to make a river straight. And during the around the early 1800s up through the Civil War, that's kind of what happened with the Mississippi. It was the age of the engineers, and they did everything they could do to control the river. So this was an illustration of the difficulty of controlling a river using this. And this will lead us into the next part of our presentation. But I would like you, this rope here was sitting, yesterday was sitting in Lowe's in rolls in a bag, and it's been cut and turned into art by you. So I would like you each to take this rope as a gift. Aww. And at least keep it for an hour. Think about this and think about our river, the Mississippi, and your river.
Thank you for sharing.
And it's our gift to you.
And we'd ask you to swiftly take a seat, and we're gonna move to the next one.
It's really nice to meet you. It's too good there.
I have two pieces. Oh. Now what do we do?
TNT souvenir.
We're sitting down.
Cheers.
What are we supposed to do? Oh. Run around or take our seats?
Oh. When we go to the next slide, if you just hit the arrow. So guys, we asked, we wanted to, we understand that the natural, the process that's happening in nature in our own home is not unique. And insofar as it's dealing with the Mississippi River, it's a very unique process to us. But I think we all understand and we are all seeing over and over. The Northeast has become the new front page headline for climate change, or there's hurricanes now in New York, three of the last 4 years or however many. And we really wanted to get you talking about what's happening in the natural world where you are, because I feel like that can be fodder for the conversation we want to have with your questions to us. We want to explain the specifics a little bit of what's happening to our home and what we're doing in response and in collaboration with nature. This is the historical distributaries of the Mississippi River. That means that's every place that the Mississippi River went for 5,000 years to build Louisiana. Rivers build land, right? They drop sediment everywhere. The thicker lines are the lines that took the course for the longest, right? So you can see this major thick line above here that comes down to what is Venice right here. That's the Mississippi River now. But that's
Venice,
what the,
Louisiana.
Yeah, and this is Louisiana, yeah. And that's what that's where we're from. And that's what the Mississippi River did for about 5,000 years, right? It was a very recent process. Very, very recent process, almost less than 100 years, where we decided to do this to the river. This is the infrastructure currently in the 20th century. As you can see, we've all of the red, that marks levee protection systems, right? So what we did, because of a variety of reasons, not just because we wanted to, because there was a lot of good things that were coming from us putting levees around the river, or at least we thought at the time. Industry, right? The Port of New Orleans, people getting jobs. It's an economic indicator, right, where we're from. There's a lot of reasons why they put levees around the river and attempt to control it. If you see over here, this is the Atchafalaya Basin, which somebody you might have heard of. You can see how wide the levees are on the opposite side of the river. And when it comes down, they allow the historical distributaries to continue to flow. That's the only place in South Louisiana making land since 1978. It's making land. It's actively pushing sediment. So this area here is making land. Everything else, if you can see from the infrastructure of the levees, and you can go to the next slide, that's the land loss that's occurring in Louisiana. Every place that's red is actively losing land. Now, the number that they use, which is kind of not an actively good number in some ways, is a football field every half hour, okay? That's not like you walk out of your backyard and a football field of land just drops into the ocean. That's a football field every half hour for most of the coast. But every place that has red right now since 1950s has been losing land. Right, we lose about 40 square miles of land a year. Now this is exacerbated by hurricanes, it's been exacerbated by rising sea levels, and it's also been exacerbated by the fact that the land, while it is eroding, is also subsiding, right? So there's this major, major land loss, okay?
And the oceans are rising.
And the oceans are rising, right? Now, the cultural amalgam that came from this land, just like the land in the Mississippi River Delta system is one of the most diverse in the world, and over those 5,000 years, all of that water built that sediment. The cultural amalgam that made Louisiana and continues to make Louisiana is just as diverse, right? So that culture came to the Delta of Louisiana because it's one of the richest places in the world. So we're talking about the Acadian people, Cajuns, the indigenous people who were already on the land, Chinese, Filipino, Vietnamese fishermen, Isleños from the descendants of the Canary Islands, people who came from all over the country to come to the port of New Orleans. It's always been sort of this transient place and this blend of all of these cultures together. So the natural process and the diversity that the River Delta gave us was also reflected in the people that have continued to come to Louisiana. Right now, one of the biggest questions that we're facing, and it's kind of one of the central theses of our work, is what happens to cultural traditions when the land that sustains them disappears? Because all of these cultural traditions that we share come from a real direct connection to the land. This is what our project Crayuan is about. And really briefly, this is what we're doing. We go to a lot of these places in Southeast Louisiana on these expeditions. We're witnessing in these places. We're listening to scientists. We're listening to stories of experts, of culture bearers, of people who work the land, of fishermen, of anyone who has been around that land, who has seen the land disappear. In some cases, in one lifetime, where they've seen in 70 years an entire place that it's in open water now, right? We're talking to those people. We're participating in direct action in those places, whether it be a rehearsal, whether it be planting trees, whether it be working the land, right? And then we're taking what we see in those images, like, if Jeff, could you move to the next slide? This is a healthy cypress forest. It's in the Atchafalaya Basin, right? In Pierre Part, Louisiana. This is what it looks like. If any of you have ever been in a swamp, it's pretty amazing. It's a floating forest. That's a pirogue. It's a flat bottom boat. And if you go to the next slide, this is the Bayou Bienvenue platform. Crayuan, this project, we had our first public sharing at the Network of Ensemble Theaters, Microfest USA. We went out and we decided to do a witnessing at this platform because if you go to the next slide, it's an example of a dead cypress forest, right? That for a variety of reasons, the dredging of canals, the saltwater intrusion, the industry and the oil companies have dredged canals, have created the conditions where the natural cypress that you just saw before can't work anymore. So the thing that we're doing is we held a performance here. It was a short sharing. This is an example of one of our performers who was playing the fiddle in the tree. If you go to the next slide, we have people in boats. That's the backside of New Orleans. But this is kind of the example of the landscape now as it stands, right? Where you no longer have what is one of the natural buffers, the cypress forest, things that are holding together the land, right? So go to the next slide. We had, these were all of the people. Some of you may even recognize yourself. I think that's Jamie right there. I think Sabrina was in this.
Before the raspberry hair.
Before the raspberry hair, you see it here. We shared a really small section of our performance. We shared a song. Moving to the next slide. And then we possessed people away with music. One of the unique things about the culture where we're from is that even though this may seem like a lot of gloom and doom, the people of Louisiana persist on celebrating loss, right? They say we put the fun in funeral down in Louisiana, right? There's a persistence on the belief that impermanence is a part of life and that the use of the culture is the use of joy and celebration as a way. And the idea of processing people, whether it be for a funeral or for a dirge or something, is a big part of that. And if we go to the next slide, this is us in the phase that we're in now. We're researching sites and locations for May, and this is the most recent location that we're out in. This is called the Central Wetlands. It's kind of like walking on the moon. It's a little mix between like the Bronze Age and the future. All of that underneath that very like springy, almost trampoline land is 2 feet of water. And this is the proposed site for what we're gonna do in May, right? The idea is to bring people in South Louisiana who have never even seen some of this, to witness it, to encounter it, to share work, performance, music, to share food, to share song, right? To share, give people a little bit of a framework and understanding of what's happening in these places. The idea for Crayuan is that, and you can leave that up, Jeff, we're gonna go to this location in May, where we're working in conjunction with the Isleños Center, which is these people who have been in Louisiana for about 300 years. We'll be performing in conjunction with that center. We'll go to two other sites in South Louisiana. We'll do that little mini part of a tour. We'll present some in New Orleans. And then in the spring, we'll get ready for a tour that's gonna happen in 2014, where we'll go from Austin up to Nova Scotia and sort of retrace the line of some of the places where our ancestors came from. So I want to invite Jeff to talk about, just for a minute, what happens when we go out to do these visits and how it affects our process when we go back into our space and into our room and on the land, stuff like that.
Yeah, as I said earlier, you know, our work is, I mean, there's so many names. Site-specific doesn't really talk about what we do. It's more this response to the environment. And I, rather than saying I'm a designer or a set designer, I say like I'm an environmental enhancer. And, you know, you go to places like this and you're like, what do you need to do? It's all there, you know, it's all there. So trying to you know, I think of environment as another character in the show. Like it speaks, and it's the neediest and loudest character in the show. It's like somebody who's yelling all the time, but is a great actor. You know, you just, you have to, you work with it. And it's so great to work in places like this, because it's beyond the beauty of the work itself in the space, the development of the work, being in that space, creating work about a space while you're in it, it brings so much to our process. It makes us feel so good while we're doing it. It makes us so good when we leave. And it's just really regenerative for us. And bringing art into the landscape is, in some ways, spiritually is regenerative for the landscape too. So I mean, there's many challenges with it. There's how you enter communities, how you go into these places, how you gain agency into these areas. But you know, it's an ongoing conversation that we've been having for 20 years, and it's bringing the environment into our work, you know, as a central character is probably one of the core elements of the work. And I think we're going to leave you with bit.
We have a little time.
Yeah, you have time. Yeah, you've got all kinds of time. Nine minutes.
Oh, cool. Just to get a little bit into the logistics of some of the things that happen. Jeff and I are part of a collective that owns and operates a space called Catapult. It's a 4,000 square foot warehouse. That's a performance laboratory design studio. It's where we do our work in our offices. So a lot of times, just in the straight process thing, when we're outdoors, we don't always stay outdoors. There's a lot of problems with being outdoors. There's rain, there's cold, there's mosquitoes, there's snakes. In the springtime, this thing will be teeming with all kinds of critters that maybe we don't want to deal with. Some of our performers don't like the idea of being alligators. By alligators and stuff like that. So we have to be real about that. So a lot of times what we do is when we're visiting sites, say, we'll have a rehearsal on Monday, we have an expedition on Thursday, we're all in the studio on Friday, right? And then Jeff is bringing in things that he wants to do to interpret that landscape. On last Friday, we were making rivers, right? We were planting rivers. Two nights ago, we're dealing with like these huge trees falling down, you know, balancing sticks. Working on our feet, using text, singing songs, making music together. So it's not all outside.
Yeah.
A lot of it occurs in a way that we take what is inspired from outside, sometimes we bring it inside, we generate material, we bring that back and see how it is responsive to the land, et cetera, right?
In our workshop, Catapult is basically a big rehearsal floor, a big sprung floor, and the design studio is right next to it. There's no wall or anything like that. So the design world and the rehearsal room are right there. So there's things that we constantly will make things right there and then, but it's not separate. And as we develop the space more, the sound system, the lighting, and you know, is all there. Even our offices are raised with our glass offices. So where we write grants, like the NEFA grant, is right in view of our rehearsal space. And you know, so it's all together. When you come into our workshop, this is the heart and soul of how we make theater. There's nothing, you see it. There's, you know, walls are painted black, there are blackboards there, and it's a real sharing. And the other thing to mention about the process, it's like, it's not director, actor, designer. It's we have like four people in this process that's at the top. And like, I work with the actors in rehearsals and direct rehearsals independent of the director and develop material with them, because my work is interactive. I make a lot of machines. I make things that are all interactive. So it's really important that I'm able to, as a designer, work directly with actors and not go through the director all the time. And that's really developed in our process. And I think it's really great. And then that work is given back to the director, and there's more material for her or him to work with.
And the last thing I would say is that we do not land in places that we do not have some sort of invitation into. We've toured an outdoor performance called Lugaru to the Co-Festival, where like when we go, we work with Sabrina at the Co-Festival. We work with partners who are already doing the work in the places that they're doing it, right? And we're there to lift up, to shine a little light, to bring some energy, to get people there. But we don't also try to do direct action environmental work. We work with partners and people who are already doing that type of policy work, or that we're working with scientists who are doing the type of scientific work. We see ourselves very specifically as an art and culture component of this whole idea of getting the word out. So we don't try to plop ourselves down and assume that art is the end. Art is the means, right? And it's got the ability to tell story and to make connection, but it is not some sort of saving grace that's gonna make these wetlands come back. In some ways, these wetlands that you just saw probably aren't coming back. They're probably gonna erode into the ocean. But there's other parts of this thing that are still savable, right? There's still ideas about how, you know, such things could be fixed.
So. I mean, also another example, like last week, for our rehearsal, we went and planted cypress trees in a forest that's being overtaken by, what was the plant?
Chinese tallow.
That's just an invasive species that's like destroying or taking over an area. So we went there and we spent a day, we planted 100 trees, and we all kind of in our own world doing that. But the movements did not, were cataloged in the head, and when we went back into the space,
we made the digging
we took
nets.
Those movements of digging and planting trees, and now it's become a score in the piece. So it kind of, so there's ways to have that creative process come from really doing some real meaningful action. Mm-hmm. And we weren't thinking about it when we did it. Like, we didn't say, let's go plant some trees and steal some ideas for movement. It just kind of happened organically, and that's what happens a lot when you make this part of your practice.
So we're going to just about turn it over to the Debate Society, who's going to come up, give you some time. We want to leave you with some words that were written by our writer, Moose Jackson, just to share with you a little bit of the images that come from the landscape where we're from, a poem about the swamp that I'll share with you. That's all we'll say. Now, at first I leaned back, half hid in those hairy cypress of almost human warmth and width. I take in the clicks and the grinding chirrups, surface sploosh and zydeco rhythms drifting across that slough. The swamp don't just incorporate you, it becomes you. It breathes you, it spooks you, unlocks and unfetters, loves your baser needs. Your demise and your decay feed it. The more rotten, the more better, baby. Yeah, I love that little Piro. How she sits so close to the water, gliding like a gator going for a baby deer. The swamp is a creed. A purgatory of water, a pilgrimage of land, a holy immaculate afterbirth from a stillborn river. The swamp is me at my best, running wild through cypress and tupelo, nutri-rat and armadillo, crawfish and crabs, man, I live like a king. You let them fools tremble when they hear me sing. It's getting close to feeding time. We about to take this boat down river. Tonight, we party down in New Orleans. Thank you for your time.
Nick curated a week of HowlRound articles, HowlRound.com, for those of you who don't know it, about the activities and things that are happening in New Orleans. It was really one of the most sort of energized weeks on HowlRound we've had. And in fact, it created a kind of a moment in my staff where everyone decided that we should move our offices to New Orleans. There was a kind of revolt, and so anyway, we had to quell that revolt after what was happening. So thanks, you guys, for
Thank
that.
You.
I really appreciate it. David had a question about the audience makeup.
About
so
who's here,
yeah, about who's here. So maybe just how many people here are students of Emerson? We're just trying to get an overall. All right, awesome. Great. How many people here because they make theater in some way that they thought it would be so cool to know how these people are working? And how many people just love theater so much they come in and that's awesome. Great. All right. I just have a sense of like who's in the room. So so next up.
And how many staff of the
faculty? Oh, and staff. I'm sorry, David. I didn't get them all. Staff. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Well, you know, various. Collaborating. So next up, Oliver Butler, Paul Thureen are from the Debate Society. I've known these guys for a little while. We've hung out in various on golf courses and various other places. It's true. It's actually true. We play golf together. Anyway, I just feel lucky to have these artists here and the different ways they work. And so normally Hannah is with them, but Hannah is coming in tonight. And so she is, as most women are, they're really the core. So they've decided that they're going to try to do the workshop without her, and I guess she's consented to letting some secrets be shared in her absence. So super enthusiastic to have you guys here.
Hi, we're the debate
two-thirds of the debate society.
Yeah, Hannah is not with us today, but she is the most fun. She is the shortest of the three of us. And you're really missing out not having her. But she gave us full permission to share all of our deep dirty secrets. Mm-hmm. We want to start by saying thank you to NIFA for having us. Thank you to Arts Emerson, David and Polly. Literally everyone that we've got here Monday evening, every single person that we've come into contact with has been super helpful, really welcoming. There's notes everywhere about how we should feel welcome. There's snacks in every room. It is literally has just been like the nicest experience so far, and we just got started. So.
Yeah, and also just want to say it's such like an honor and a pleasure to be. To be paired up with Mondo Bizarro. We just met and we sort of felt this kinship with each other. And the way that you were speaking about your work, I looked over and Oliver was nodding. And this will get a little into what we're gonna be doing today, that a lot of what we do is sort of this intuitive collection and generating of a bunch of material, these little tiny moments, until we find those little things that really hit, and then like stripping away the other things. So that's a lot of what we're gonna do. And then also I just wanted to say that I grew up very close to the headwaters of the Mississippi in Minnesota, so every year that would be our family vacation, walking across the headwaters of the Mississippi. Mm-hmm. So I feel like we also have this interesting geographic connection in history, so. Great.
Yeah. When we make work, it's Hannah, Paul, and I are the core members of the company. Hannah and Paul are actors and writers. I'm a director, and the authorial work I do in the process I call developing. But really, when we start the work, the three of us don't have roles. We're all researchers and co-collaborators who all interact in the rehearsal room to try and figure out what it is we want to spend 2 years making a play on. And as Paul said, it starts very intuitively. You know, you're sort of in a dark room together, and you're bringing things that move you, and you're trying to find connections between those things. Until eventually, what we do is when we find that one thing that we want to focus in, we try and then populate that one thing with what we call the world of the play. So we sort of build out everything about what the theater piece might be. It could be the characters, it can be language, it can be music. It's sort of this entire, it's an entire world of play that doesn't really have a structure yet. And it's very late in the process that then we take this mass saturation of material and we say, you know what, we're gonna focus on this, here's the story. And it's at that point that Hannah and Paul sort of separate out more as writers and I become more of a director. But it's always coming on the heels of like a lot of this experiential work in rehearsal.
So Blood Play is the play that we're doing here as part of the festival, so I hope everybody can come and see that. And if you do, or if you have, something that people really, always comment about are the cocktails and the games that are in the play. So the play takes place in a basement in Skokie in the 1950s, and there's all these cocktails and games that we came up with doing a bunch of research into the era, and then coming up with our own invented versions of those, and sort of creating that mythology, those very early lists and games that we do to create that. That's what really flavors the piece, and so that's what we're going to be doing with you guys today. So everybody needs
pen and
page. So if anybody has paper and writing materials, that's great.
We also have some extra ones. Just put your hand. What?
No liquor.
No real cocktail. Sorry.
You'll be keeping it.
Come on by.
Yeah, that's a good question. You'll be keeping this. You're not going to turn it in. So if you have a journal or a notebook, you can write in that. Yeah.
I don't have anything.
Just put your hand up. They have.
They'll be coming around.
They'll be coming around.
Why don't you raise your hand if you need a pen and paper?
There's more pens.
Oh, thank you.
Should I get my stuff wiped up?
Yeah. More pens? Anyone pens? Pens? Anyone?
No.
I'm not texting. I'm just trying to find my stopwatch. If anybody was on the tweet up last night, you'll know that technology isn't our forte.
We are sort of known as like an analog theater company because we do focus in creating worlds out of like these historical times that seem familiar but are always sort of our invented versions of those places and times.
Stopwatch. Great.
So we're going to take you through a few of the phases of the work we do. And realize this usually happens over like 2 years, so we're going to fast track it. But we're going to try and like touch on a number of these things, because when you're making something, when you don't know what it is, a lot of it is about sort of like tricking yourself to be creative and populate the world and eventually look at things you've created, throw out most of it, but be able to like isolate the things of value quickly that are sometimes tiny. You know, a lot of times we're looking for these tiny little moments. Hannah and Paul will write early in the process like three words or like one line, which invariably become a part of the piece in the end. Somehow the earliest stuff ends up, at least we end up like noticing how it's like there in the end. So we're gonna take you through some of like the tricks we use to sort of generate when you know nothing and be able to like stay productive and move forward when you don't know exactly where you're going.
So we'll call this section lists. So we love making lists at the beginning. So you're gonna make a bunch of lists. So it's gonna be really quick, so don't think too much. We'll tell you what you're gonna make a list of and how much time you have, and then we'll sort of
Build you through it.
Okay,
right now you're gonna start. You're gonna be making a list of five invented island names. So the names of five invented islands that you think of, and you're gonna have, we'll give you a minute and a half.
You can have a minute and a half. Five invented island names. Go. Okay, you're halfway, so you should have about 2.5 island names done.
Are these supposed to be made up?
Made up. Yeah. These are your own invented islands. You can overcreate and then just isolate five.
Okay, so look over your list of island names, and you're gonna pick your favorite one. This is gonna be your island, that everything else we do today is gonna take place on that island of yours.
For whatever reason, it's the one that like immediately sort of evokes the most thoughts for you, you know, that you're most drawn to for whatever reason. Just give a second to look at them and isolate that one.
Okay, so if you have your island, our next list.
Our next list. Okay, so now thinking of yourself on this island, we want you to come up with a list of the five most important indigenous plants on that island, invented or real. I would say, let's say there has to be at least one invented plant and at least one real plant.
Five plant names. You have 1 minute. Go.
Thank you.
should have said we hope people at home are also doing this. Feel free to tweet in any of your lists to hashtag
TNT Fest.
Which took us.
We just got into Twitter last night, so that's all we're talking about.
Okay, great. So now you have your plans. Okay, this next one is a list of one, and you're going to have 30 seconds to come up with the island's most popular dog breed, and this is invented. You're inventing the island's most popular dog breed. You're going to have 30 seconds to make.
And really look at what you've created so far, and let that sort of inspire this. You know, just as you
go. All right, hopefully you have your dog.
All right, now what you're gonna do is you're gonna write down the three most important dates on the island. These are not holiday names, these are just dates.
This is my favorite one. Just three dates.
Three dates, you need three dates.
January 13th, yeah. 1972.
Hey.
Is that yours? Okay, three important dates, 30
Except
seconds.
Except for January 13th.
Go. A list. We told Polly that we really we made this workshop aimed at her. So now this is perhaps the most important list. What you're going to come up with is the three most popular sports on the island. Now these are invented sports. You don't have to know how to play the sport. You don't have to know what the sport is. Just the name of the three most popular sports played on the island. You have a minute and 40 seconds for this. You have 30 seconds. You should have about 2.1 sports done.
Cool, just take 1 second. Now, when we're making a piece, right, it's not like everything we create, we keep, it's all gold. A lot of times you gotta like take a look at things you create and you gotta be like, okay, what jumps out at me now? Like, what's the most interesting? What am I most drawn to? Because we might take any bit of something that we create, right? And we might then spend like 2 weeks researching that, or we might go on a trip to sort of accentuate like why we're drawn to it. We're constantly asking ourselves like, why are we drawn to this thing? Or like, what unites these disparate ideas? Just take a second and star anything on what you've written down that is like the most interesting for you. Just like 15 seconds, just quickly the things that jump out at you the most. If anyone, I'm not gonna force anybody to share, but if anyone wouldn't mind just like sharing some of their like, their. It's hard in like a room to just be like, this is what I think is good that I wrote. But something that like, just for you, you're like, you know what, I like this for some reason. If you can put your sort of self-consciousness aside and just like share something that like jumped out at you from what you created. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so my dog is Blue Bark Terrier. I don't know what that means.
Blue Bark Terrier.
And then one of my most popular sports is Dance of Computer Death, which I think involves throwing broken computers at people.
Nice. We don't know exactly what it was. It's an old time sport. Yes.
Yeah. Well, the most popular sport on Palm Wine Island is sand rowing, in which canoes are placed side by side on the beach with the object of rowing them through the sand away from the ocean.
Nice.
It's very popular. It's very popular.
Strong.
Yeah.
On the island of Kukuli, there's lots and lots of shushus growing. And you play foos.
I love that.
You know? Period.
Yeah. That's fantastic. Fantastic. Anybody else? Yeah.
On the island of Borina, which is covered with succulaceous, a sport is played underwater blading, which was brought to the island on May 6, 1636, which also brought the favorite dog, which is the miniature red snuffera.
I have two things. It's a very sexy sounding island. Yeah. And also it's interesting how the stories are already emerging, you know what I mean? These connections from these lists are already happening. Like two more.
Theater people in a room. Yeah.
It's the Cole Family Sanctuary. Ooh. And there's a plant on this island that's called Dia Beet Ease. So it's spelled DIA-BEAT-EASE, and it cures diabetes. And the sport is bat mitten, real bat.
On the island of Palm Terrace, there are herba iguanas and plants and fleur anemones. And the most popular dog breed is the palm rat, and people play dog ball and palm throw.
one more, yeah.
Well, on the Isle of Impunity, the most prevalent plant is the willowy willow algae, and the dogs running around are Plutonia scaramouche, and the game they play is bebop a rhubop marshmallow flush.
Oh,
beautiful. Right. Yes.
Okay, we're going to transition to another section, but first we got one more just to wrap up this list section. Look at your sports names. And pick the juiciest sport, the one that you think has the most creative potential to work on a little bit. So pick your sport.
It's like 10 seconds. This is what you're gonna focus on for the rest of the time.
You have to make up how to play it?
Not yet, no.
Okay, list section.
Done.
That was like a year of that. No, we don't sit around doing like a year of lists. I mean, what you're doing is you're like, we're all bringing these things, like for, you know, for blood play, we literally came up with a list of cocktails. inspired by real cocktails, but none of them are, they're all invented, and then we decided how they were made.
I mean, it's just sort of like, it's a part of how we sort of like build out the world. But let's say like this is like a year into it, we know a little bit more of like what we're creating. Mm-hmm. We do something called the bad plays. And this is just something that, it's another way in which when we've gotten far enough into creating a lot of what we think the play is, or like what the world is, and you get sort of stuck trying to like be brilliant all the time, it's like a lot more interesting for us and easier for us to think like, what is like the worst, what is the worst way to do what we're doing? Sometimes it's like more apparent, and sometimes that like leads us to more sort of like free form, interesting and exciting options. So what we'd like you to do, this is also going to be a writing exercise. What you're going to do is you are going to write, and I want this to be like a pen never leaves the paper kind of writing exercise. You are going to write a pre-game pep talk as a coach for this sport. I realize, you know, we don't know yet exactly how the sport works. You do not have to explain to us how the sport works. You are basically in the locker room, if there is a locker room with this sport. You are there with the team, giving them the pregame pep talk. It is the worst pregame pep talk that you can muster.
Oh yeah, you have more paper.
Do we have more paper?
Yes, over here.
Great. Awesome. Anyone need more paper?
There you go. So you have 2 minutes to write a stream of consciousness.
Oh, thank you.
Worst possible pregame pep talk to the players of your sport. Begin. All right, is anybody brave enough to share your bad pep talk?
I'll do it.
Yeah.
It's not all done though, I only got like a quarter of the way through.
Of course, okay. Yeah.
Pep talk. Okay.
The game had to start, so.
Yeah. All right, here it is, gentlemen and ladies of the Wild Lamb Nation Court. It's today and the sun is shining as dimly as it did on January 1st, 1000. When our forefathers and foremothers first harnessed the initial wolverhound pack and made it and rode them into the dark green sea in search of the deep crevice in which the stringiest eucalypt brain tree could be found. I send you out, and that's as far as I got.
Right. That's a good end. Send you out. Yeah, go for it.
Okay, team.
The dogs are fed, right? All y'all ate? Uh-huh. No. Okay, go out there and play. Well, play well and clean. Remember your skates should be on your feet, the correct feet. Look at your competitors, teams from other counties.
That's awesome.
Okay, this is to a single player for the game, Leapers, Guess.
There's a very high chance you're gonna die out there, kid. But don't worry about it, because there's nothing you can really do to prepare yourself. It's called Leaper's Guess, kid, not Leaper's No. I can say I was proud of you, but honestly, you've been slacking off a lot lately, and it's been pissing me off.
Morning.
Oh, me? Oh, okay. Guys, it's easy. There's no wrong way. Can't be a fool. I mean, you start with hugs, and you cheer each other, and really have fun, and you help each other.
That's really good.
David.
Okay, guys. As you know, we suck as a team. We don't hold that against each other. Nobody on this team is going to blame anybody else on this team for the fact that we lose today. We will lose because our gene pool is depleted. We can't force each other. We can't force other people to come to Void, that's the name of the island, to live. And why would they? What we can do is play. We can play our asses off. We can kick that sand and eat that sand and fake injuries if we have to. That's as far as
that's good. That's great. One more, Morgan.
Okay, folks, well, we all know what we're here to do, and for those of you who may be hearing this for the last time, well, yeah, I don't really know what to say. I mean, I guess it was nice knowing you. And you may know the frondaceous are especially spiny this year. All that rain that helped your flowers grow, Marge, also gave them especially long and sharp spines, so I hope you reinforced your shin guards. And they are really fast this year. I mean, really fast. Like that miniature red snuffler of Jack's with only three legs. Well, it wandered to the edge of the patch and, yeah, okay, so run fast, I guess. Yeah.
I'm totally inspired to play these sports very awfully, very awfully. Okay, one more.
Okay. Okay, men, this is it. Everything depends on you. On here. On now. You only get one shot. You hit the mark, or you don't. And if you don't, well, you know what that means. Ignominy. A return to a dark time. A return to... you. Walter, what are you doing? Stop that!
You've got character in there. That's great. That's great. Yeah. And just to like check in, none of these things would become the play for us. Like, you know what I mean?
No, I mean, hey, yours are great. All of yours are the play. All of yours are the play. But like, really,
you're not as talented though. So it's
You might isolate like one thing in that is of interest. If like all three of us are like, you know, it's really interesting to like call out the unseen character at the end of the piece, you know, you assume it's a whole room, or find out it's just one person. It's like the little secrets and the little switches that sort of reveal themselves to us as we talk about those things, then we focus in on that. Like rarely does like the bad play then become like, now we do that thing. Or that the list, like now we're just gonna like read this list. It ends up just sort of infusing other research and other focuses as we move forward.
And if we had a challenge, like in a play, if we had to write a really good pregame pep talk, the end to that would be writing the bad pregame pep talk. Because there's always something rooted in that that's the key to finding the good thing. Because if you sit down and you're like, I gotta write something really awesome, you sit there for a long time.
And now we're gonna shift out of bad plays, and we're gonna shift into something called etudes. And this is the more like active part of the more like physically active part. I mean, we are a super nerdy theater company, so we do a lot of reading, a lot of talking, a lot of sharing. So that is
a lot of crying.
I cannot deny that like we do spend a lot of time doing that. But we are also like physically active in the room. Hannah and Paul are actors who create. I get involved in this as well. We have something called etudes, which are very sort of small theatrical experiments or challenges that we like set for each other based on the research that we've done, based on the things that we've created to try and like physically figure out how some of this stuff works. All of which does not become the play either. Again, trying to isolate the little things that we're gonna hold on to and make a part of the world. So what we'd like is we'd like all of you to pair off. I would like you to pair off with someone you are not sitting directly next to, and someone you don't like work with all the time. So I wonder if it would be easier to...
Right here. Okay.
Is everybody going to be able to do that? Might be easier if we make you do it somehow. Yeah. Introduce yourself. Get up. You're going to go to a different part of the room. Don't be scared.
So let's start with that. Pair up and find a spot in the room.
Find a spot in the room. Raise your hand if you don't have a partner right now. Don't be. Yeah, come out of the. Yeah.
Come out of the dark.
Yeah, come out of the dark. Yeah, it's good. Raise your hand if you're not paired up. I know it's awkward to be like, yeah, go find your pair. And you're like, me, sort of. Not paired. Would you guys mind working together? Yeah? Great.
Where are you? Oh.
Anyone else who's not paired off? Find your partner. Anyone?
I think we're the last two.
Okay, find yourself like a spot in the room, all right? Give yourself a little bit of space. Give yourself some space. Don't get all up on each other. There's a lot of room in here.
Okay.
Cool. Okay. So first, you're going to work together eventually, but first I want you each to take a minute and you are going to design a drill for the beginning of the sport that you picked, a drill that you would lead a team through. So you want to design the drill that is specifically designed to like warm up and make a team better at the sport that you invented. Okay? Don't spend a whole lot of time trying to make it brilliant. Just decide what the drill is for yourself on your own. And then eventually you'll be sharing it with each other. But start by just working on your own and think through the specific elements of the drill. Make a drill. You've got 2.5 minutes. Feel it in your body. Try it out for yourself. Try it out a little bit yourself.
Ready?
And then you'll be working together. Go.
Umwah. It sounds like fun. What's your sport? I'm just gonna work out.
It's just falling. So
okay.
There's really no drill for that. I don't know. It's just like. I'm not sure what else. Yeah, except like.
What you're going to do now with your partners, you're going to take turns. What you're going to do is you're going to be the coach. You're going to tell your partner the name of the sport. And then you're going to lead them through a minute of that warm-up. Talk them through it. Show them how they're going to do it.
So just pick who's going to go first real quick. Just like someone decide who's going to go first.
All right.
And
sure.
The first person has a minute. Go ahead.
All right, so ready? Legs open, then you're going to point, yeah, right toe, and bend your knee like you're lunging, and it's toe, knee, but make sure your elbows are sticking out. Toe, knee, and then you put your arms out, and your big X, put your left toe back, yeah.
Wrap up the first round and switch pretty soon.
Second
round.
So the way they do that is the way to do that is to try to get your pelvis in front of your head.
No, never.
Yes. And you can practice also on your sides. Yes. I have a broken foot.
Left down. No, never. Back up.
Yeah.
No, never.
So it's all about
not taking a shot. No, never.
Good.
No.
All right. Have everybody come down here. Everyone down here facing the audience. Facing the, yeah, everyone in this area here. I was going to say if you wanted to use your rope.
I actually have a rope.
Yeah, everybody come in here. Sort of face this way. Now, preferably someone who hasn't shared yet, but hopefully a brave soul, would someone like to lead us all through their drill? Yeah, take it. Now, would you, if you're able to do it physically, can you either, if you need all the space, do it here, or like go up there and do it there, okay. And we'll do it from here, yeah. Get some space.
Fine.
Yeah.
So the name of my sport's called Walls of Ball Junk Slam, and do I want to explain the sport first?
Up to you. Take us through the drill, okay. and then tell us
the
about
drill?
It.
Okay, so the drill is all about getting your pelvis in front of your head. In as many directions and turns as possible. So that's the most important thing.
Can you show it?
And it's, the best way is for me, since I have a broken foot, I can't do it. But to jump and then just like get it in front of you, or if you want, you can do it on the ground and just go.
Okay. All right, lead us through.
Okay, so you guys can all do it standing. I'll do it on the floor. Okay, so. Okay. Okay. And now on the
right.
And now on the right side. So turn it. And then do that three times. And now do the other side three times. And now one more time forward.
More popcorn.
Cool.
Nice. I gotta say, what's really fun about that to me is it's actually more fun not knowing what the sport is. Like, I love, from a storytelling standpoint, I love the idea of like, of seeing like the coach explain the drill to get your pelvis in front of your head, and not knowing like how that functions in the sport. Like, to me, I want to know what that sport is, and I'm so happy that you're not telling us what that sport is. Like, from a theatrical standpoint, like, I'm in, you know? Yeah. Anybody else? Anyone else? Take us through? Yeah, show us.
Okay.
Lead us through it.
This is for the game Bocce Bells. And you're holding your bocce bells in each hand. And you want to be making the best sound possible by hitting them together as hard as you can in the following drill. So you're going to go up right, down left, up left, down right, behind you, down low, and then once in front of you. Cool. You want to do it all together one more time? Okay. It goes right, down left, up left. Down right, behind you, below, and one.
All right, one more. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
Okay. I'm not going to tell you the name because it would ruin it. So put your arms in front of you and imagine your bat. And we're going to find the best bat for this game by shaking vigorously. Okay. Did it break? If it's broken, you can't use it. Okay. Then you're going to have to shake some other bats. Okay, now let's make our balls. Pick them up and shape them. Add a little spit. Now you're ready to play hot dog baseball.
Yeah. I would say also, your first line, that would be like another thing. I would just out of nowhere, I'm not going to tell you the name, because if I did, it would ruin it. Like, even like outside of the context of sport, that immediately you're like,
what?
I don't know, I'm in. I love it. All right, everyone take a seat. We'll just.
Awesome.
Yeah,
guys.
Thank you. Well done. Well done, guys. Get some water. Yeah.
How'd you break your foot?
Long story. Playing that game.
I was pole dancing on the boat.
Oh.
So when we're making plays, a lot of what we do is figuring out how to make each play. You know, so part of the exercises or routines and creation methods that we use, they're tweaked for the specific play, so we're always inventing them. But there's certain things that we always come back to just because we like them, making lists, imagining the worst possible version of things, and then doing these etude works, giving each other physical assignments to do, have sort of over time are sort of some building blocks that always come back to us. So as we said, to sort of like debrief this, what we're doing at this point is sort of creating the mythology of the world. So things that we think are interesting, little moments, little nuggets, little words, little ideas. There's that's sort of like the way to get out of your own way to sort of create these things.
And because we don't start out looking for the narrative, we tend to be, you know, a narrative emerges in most of our plays. Like we do end up tending towards some sort of a narrative, but we spend a lot of time trying to figure out moods and figure out like how something feels, which is why a lot of our plays are set in like our version of sometimes very real places, because like we may go there, we may research it, and we're trying to figure out like what evokes that like special feeling. And that's what we're looking for when we like do these experiments. We throw most of the stuff away, but the little moments that evoke some sort of like a mood that feels right for the world is the kind of thing that we're gonna focus in on, and we're gonna keep trying to do that more and more. Mm-hmm. And just to talk about like the stuff that we're doing beyond Blood Play, we opened in October and we just did at the Under the Radar Festival. And we're super excited to be here with Blood Play. There's another piece we're working on called The Light Years that David saw an early version of. It's about the World's Fairs in Chicago in 1893 and 1933. And Polly saw a second version of so David was at the first Sundance we were at, and Polly was at the second one as a creative advisor. And so that play is a play that now is, we've done a full development on. It's not finished, but it's near complete. And we're working to find a theater to present that in addition to touring Blood Play. That's it. Thank you so much for being with us.
They're Nick and Jeff on there. So why don't you guys come on up, and then they'll be like, you know, we can sort of stand here and look attractive in the camera.
I'm gonna pause it.
Thanks so much.
Thank
really,
you.
Really, really fun. And the sports is right in my wheelhouse.
Yeah.
For that. I was trying to think of
sports.
Yeah, some migration of ping pong and golf.
That's right. She did kick my ass in both ping pong and golf.
So this is I'd love to do just a quick Q&A for people, I'm happy to kind of moderate that. So I'll let the audience, jump in. Does anybody have any questions for either? Yeah, please.
I have a question. This is something that always fascinates me about artists who work alone to create work and artists who work collaboratively. And how do you pick the people that you want to work with, and how do you build the trust, and how do you get at that very subjective aesthetic yes? Like, how do you all have this blender of recognition that
one thing we do is we've kept the collaborative core very small for us, but we do, I should say, like, we involve designers very early in the process, but not at the very beginning, and we involve other actors early in the process, but not at the very beginning. So one step we took is by keeping the initial collaborative group small and develop our trust, like, within the three of us. But when we start adding new people, we've realized, we think it's like, it feels like such a comfortable process for us, but every new person that we've added, there is like a learning curve there. And I think it just, it goes along with that person being able to trust, them being able to trust that the process will lead somewhere and that they won't look silly in the end. So it really has to, for me, it has to do with one, working with people you work with a lot, and when you find good people you click with, making sure you continue to work with them, and then when you involve new people, helping to guide those new people through a really painful time that will end in them being like totally bought in. But I think every new person, I can't say that there's never been a new person who's worked with us who's, where there's been no friction leading up to that place where they're like, ah, I feel so comfortable in this.
So much energy is given in a good way to figuring out how to make that work, to make people trust what you're doing, and they have to trust that we know we're doing, and we trust them to get there, you know. But the other thing that you said that I just want to touch on is sort of like having that that yes, this is right moment. And for us, it's really helpful with the three of us who sort of found each other because of a shared aesthetic interest and shared values. But we've spent so much time together just figuring out how stories work that often we know that we will be arguing a lot about what's the right thing, knowing that the right thing, we'll know it when we see it, and that the three of us will find that, but that it's not voting. It's never voting. It's never us saying like, well, the two of us like this idea, and it's never convincing the other, but we go through the action and the act of convincing each other because we know we have to do that to then go home, dream about it, and then come in, and usually one of us will have that thing that's like, oh, I know what it is, and I know when I go in that I'm gonna say, hey, Oliver and Hannah, this is what we were looking for, and then we got that.
Our process is a little bit different in the sense that in probably the last several projects we've done, we have what we call the instigator. There's somebody who brings a project to the table, like Cryu One, brings it to the table, and almost that person is almost never the director. Which has a lot of challenges, but it's really interesting because the person who brings the idea at the table said, this is an idea, this is what I want to do, and we're fundraising for it, and we see, you know, what we have funding to do, because we're always trying to find funds for different projects. And that person releases to the group, which is usually a small collaborative team of like, you know, usually 3 to 4 people, which is usually designer, writer, the instigator, and the director. And through that, we work, but it's really interesting from my point, if I'm not the instigator or the director of the project, how that balancing act that goes between the director and the instigator, and it's only successful because of a deep love and trust in the collaboration, and it's a difficult road, but it's really beautiful when it happens. But it's interesting in the sense that you have to kind of release your idea to the ether, say, okay, here it is, and I am okay with where the group takes it.
I think one thing too is that I learned the hard way, which is that people are quite likely to want to go on a journey where they don't know what the end is going to be, but you have to invite them into that journey and maybe agree that we're going to go on that journey together. I think people find it much more difficult when they don't know what's going on and they haven't been explained, like, how we're not going to know what this play is for 6 months. Mm-hmm. But when you say, I'm inviting you into a process where you're going to have to trust us, and you're going to have to understand that we might not know something for a long time, and it's still going to be difficult, when they consent to that, I feel like they do a lot better. I've been in rooms where we didn't make that invitation, and the stuff got hairy.
I'll say Michael Cyril Creighton, who's in Blood Play, he was the first actor to work with us that wasn't Hannah and Paul. Hannah and Paul, their first three plays were just Hannah and Paul plays. He was the first person. He went through sort of a process of like getting to know us. Now he's been in most of our plays. He's the one who we sort of sick on new people. Like, I mean, we try and provide a safe space for people to like engage in the process, but it's actually even stronger to have sort of like, he's sort of like a good virus in the room, sort of like going up to someone privately and being like, trust it. I promise you, trust it. You know, I'm living proof. Trust it. And so we use him.
He's our mole.
He's our mole.
In that vein, when is because you're generating work, you're working with, you know, the environment. You guys are working with these lists, and you know, you make a million of them, and you hit on one thing. When's a play done or a project done? How do you identify that moment?
We consciously don't close out plays unless the I can't think of one. We Mondo Bizarro doesn't do any work that we did before Katrina. Mm-hmm. Everything else is alive, and at any moment could be toured, could come back, could be worked on. I got notes. We in Lugaru, I think at our 75th performance, my director Kathy Randall gave me notes after every performance. I hope to get notes every time I ever perform. I mean, mm-hmm. that's one of the reasons I feel like I've chosen to work this way. It's like, I don't want to stop working on the show. Mm-hmm. And I hope that the show gets worked on every day, you know, that we work on it. So I think that's to the purview of the company a lot in a lot of ways, but I think personally that's the way I feel. It's done to a certain extent, but aren't you always seeing things where you're like, God, like when you do 50 performances of a show, then you're like, oh, now I see what we have. Oh, and all this stuff is garbage. We need to change this or work this, you know. So I feel like it's a moment of discovery.
We keep adjusting our shows every time we get the chance to mount them. And it has everything to do with how much resource and time you have to put towards it. I'm at nearly every performance, and I tend to give notes after every performance. You know, we pretend the show is locked once we've, like, you know, once it's mounted. We're not bringing designers back in to retech things unless we really have to. But in general, yeah, we just keep working.
I think, in my history, you know, there's recurring themes. Like, there's shows that I worked on 15 years ago, and then something comes up that's really related to the research to that. And then there's these kind of one-off shows that kind of go, you do them, and they don't really have a life anymore, you know, like the themes don't connect, and like this show that we're doing connects to two other shows, so it's kind of like it's continued research, you know, because our work is very much about trying to learn more about something, and this is the vehicle we use, so it's just we're still interested in why Louisiana is disappearing, you know, so we're continually making work to better understand it, better understand what we can do, so.
Yeah.
In your respective companies, how long was your trial and error period when you started to decide, oh, these are the building blocks that we're going to that we're going to try and use every single time?
I think we had an interesting situation. Hannah and I went to college together and created a play together. So when we first started working with Oliver, it was sort of us figuring out how to work together on something new. And we didn't start a company. We started with doing a show, and I think that sort of the way we work and our aesthetic and our building blocks has very much slowly developed over 8 or 9 years. Mm-hmm. But it is interesting to me, if you looked at our very first play, which is based on this Russian avant-garde poet named Daniel Harms, it looks and feels very different than our plays now, but there's sort of core values in that. A big thing was collisions, that this is a writer who would write stories that had sort of that didn't have an ending or were smashed up, it would end. It would be a story about a beautiful day and then it would end, and then a small child fell off a park bench and broke both his jawbones, and then I went home. And it was just these collisions that didn't have an arc to it, and these surprising, a surprising different way of thinking about stories. That was something that was in our very first day of collaboration. You know, so there's certain things that are just values because of who we are that have always been there, but I think the techniques of bad plays and lists and etudes, that's sort of something that each play, when we're like, how do we do this?
Yeah.
Figuring it out each time, each play we add something new. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, I think less about the techniques that we use for every show and more about the ethos that we carry when we walk into the room. That it's my responsibility to be my best every day working, and then to get out of the way of the techniques we usually use when we need to, mm-hmm. and to use them for efficiency's sake when we don't. When I first started working with Jeff, I kept you're saying all these ideas, but I don't understand how you're gonna do them. And Jeff was like, well, you know, I don't mean to like offend you, but your how questions are really starting to piss me off. and he said, we put a man on the moon. I can figure out how to hang some stuff, like, and rig some stuff. And that's why I was like, he invited me into to let's dream big and bring a really big work ethic and ethos in the room. And then we'll figure out how to do it. We can mm-hmm. figure out how to do it, you know? So mm-hmm. I think of like cleaning our feet before we walk in the space and really being ready to work for mm-hmm. the 3 to 7 hours mm-hmm. we get a day. Mm-hmm. Rather than like, are we going to use that same sequence of actions that we used to yeah. make the last show? Maybe we will, but maybe that's not making it. Mm-hmm. You know.
Just to react to that, our answer for like the first year and a half of like how we're gonna do stuff is real magic.
Real magic.
And that's just like
figure it out.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'd be like, how are we gonna do that? We're like real magic.
Real magic.
I learned a great phrase when we were in Serbia doing this Luca Rose show. We had to do something and I said, well, somebody said, that's going to be impossible to do. And the guy who was helping, he said, impossible will take one day longer.
That's great.
How do people watch your work? So one of the questions I always have when you come to a festival, like the next thing, I mean, we all know, we have a better sense of how to watch a story. You know, we sort of know the elements of story. But how should we watch your work? And in your case, we are going to actually be watching it, and yours, we're going to go wherever we can to watch it, but we won't see it this week. But how do we watch?
For our work, it's like your experience of our work starts when you get out of your car or get off your bicycle. Like, it's always a journey. Our audience almost always moves from one place to another. But for me, theater is a journey, you know, from beginning to end. So I want, as soon as they get there, to start experiencing it, long before an actor or they see anything. So there's always a walk or something that leads you, or over a levee or something that brings you into a new place.
I don't know if it's a really good question, like how to watch our work. We do think about it a lot because we've come up in sort of the downtown New York experimental theater community, but some of our more recent plays structurally have tended to resemble sort of scripted work, mm-hmm. like single author work. Mm-hmm. So I've spent like every play that we've ever made being like, is this to this? There's always that moment at the end. It's always at the end. It's like, you know, we did Snowhen that had no words, almost no words. And we went into that play and we were like, is this a play? I don't even know if this is a play. What do we make? You know, and then the next play we did at the Ontological, which is, it was like Richard Foreman's theater, for people who don't know that. I was like, is this not, you know, right for this? Like, is the audience here, like, is it too conventional? Is this play too conventional? It's always at the end where you start getting like, I get nervous mm-hmm. about like, where do we fit in with like how people are gonna view this? But that's like a very sort of like small period of time at the very end. So I think like, how should people come to the work? I just always hope they come. Just come to the work. Open enough to be surprised in subtle ways.
I would say, I think that we do have like a trust and a love for the audience and that we do sort of, that the audience does sort of fill in. You know, when we're talking about the idea of like not knowing what the sport is, but wondering what the sport is that you have to put your hips in front of your head. Like, I think that we, like, that's what we, that what we, how we want the audience to work is to be, you know, to be like filling in that part of the story for them, for themselves, you know? And a lot of people, it's never in a fuck the audience sort of way. It's sort of bringing them into this world, but trusting the audience to sort of fill in the other parts of the story.
I imagine that it's also, it would be fun to know, like, I'm not gonna see you guys work for 2 years, so I'm hoping that when I go see a debate society show that I might hate it, but at least I know they're gonna kind of take care of my experience.
Right.
Like, they've been working to take care of my experience. And I think the most valuable conversations are the ones where people really don't like your work. Mm. And then that's where we're getting somewhere. You know, the meh, it's pretty good. You know, and right. So if you work for 2 years, the real nerve-wracking thing that gets on my mind is like, people haven't seen our work in 2 years. They've basically forgotten about us. And are they gonna like this or not? But like, we're trying to guard and take care of their experience and nurture their experience. And we're trying to show them something and give them something that they haven't seen. And if they don't like it, great. Mm-hmm. You know, but like, I think that's what's really nice about knowing that a company's worked for 2 years. It's mm-hmm. like, I know they're gonna do something mm-hmm. for me. You know,
right.
Whether it's my type of wine, I don't know.
I love that idea about something that they've never seen before. You know, it's always rooted in the story and what we wanna do, but that thought does come in there. Like, if I was sitting in an audience, how would I want a play to start that would blow my mind or be interesting or challenging to me? Like, what haven't I seen? What would I like to see?
Additional questions? Yeah, David.
I have a question. You guys, so all of you have picked this way of working, some, or it picked you or whatever. I think for a lot of people here, the gulf between thinking about work and performing work is huge. And how have you crossed the How do you stay in it and be able to make work in this way? And how did you get going? What's kept you going? Now you have these NEPA grants, and you have there's different kind of support now, but you didn't have those. You didn't start from we have the money. You didn't start from we have the theater. You didn't start from we have an audience. how have you stayed here, and what's kept you going now?
Something that these guys said, just talking about your space and having like the offices, as I imagined it, tell me if I'm wrong with this, but your offices sort of there where you do the work, reminded me of something that we started with early on, which was embracing the business side of the company as an extension of the artistic work. Mm-hmm. Not just because it had to happen, because no one else was gonna do it for free, but because we imagined that, you know, we wanted every bit of the company to be embedded with the feel and the mood of the work. So we would just use our artistic skills and focus to guide everything about the company, what the postcards look like, what the website looks like, how the grants are written, how our emails are written. I mean, if any of you have received an email from us, it has probably, you know, top secret, has probably actually been passed around to all three of us to make sure it captures the exact tone that, like,
we want to treat people.
How we want to treat people. So it slows things down quite a bit, and it makes us a little bit sluggish sometimes. But I think that the early decision to just embrace, to make the art and the business one, was something that I think kept us going.
I think right now we're getting in all these conversations about how work is made, and they're really exciting conversations and sometimes confusing conversations. And us being a devised theater group, that now people have done some licensed productions of our play. So what that means when somebody else is taking one of our scripts and doing it, and they're sort of strange, confusing conversations sometimes, you know. But bottom line, it maybe sounds a little cheesy, but we just love making stuff together. You know what I mean? And so if there's no support, if there's nothing, we still make stuff together. And God bless, you know, NEPA and Arts Emerson for supporting the work and making things easier and helping us do more things. But we love working with each other, even if it's, you know, in Oliver's house, which is like where we do a lot of the work. It's just like we get together and we make plays.
Yeah, and the money will go away, and we'll be right where we were. Mm-hmm. And there'll be ebbs and flows and good times and bad times. I, for me, singularly, the moment that kept me in it was Katrina. Mm-hmm. It was like, I was a young artist, very impressionable, didn't know anything about what I was doing, really, I felt like. And just seeing, all, like, having elders and mentors and people like Jeff, like, when I enter that work. No, but Jeff had been doing the work for 15 years before I even thought about what I was doing, you know? And listening to that way of thinking, and then like the Katrina moment was like, the social function was clear. This is why we're doing our work. This is what's going on. It's about our home, and for right now, that's what it is. And it became real easy to feel that sense of community and empowered to do the work, and it still feels that way. And that might go away, you know? I mean, the big question in New Orleans we have is like, how has it not become a hobby for people who are now getting into their 40s and are raising kids and trying to do that thing? I mean, that's real. That is real. It's not like, so what do we do there? What keeps us in it? And for me, it's like when I watch like the musicians in Louisiana, they like got a pretty clear understanding of what their social function is. They like get you together, they move you around in space, they usually feed you, and they create a lot of joy. And they don't ever get on the mic and say, this is community-engaged Zydeco dance. You know? They don't ever say that. Just do what they do, because that's part of how they breathe, you know? And for a little bit now, it's been how we breathe. I don't know if that'll last, but for right now, that's what it feels like, you know?
It's about, for me, just creating meaningful actions. And I've been doing it for so long. I surround myself with passionate people, you know, not just artists, but anything they do that through our research, and it's just, I love how I spend my days. You know, my days are deep, they're rich. Boredom is something I've never experienced or haven't experienced in my adult life, because every moment of my day is really geared around making art or doing something creative. Like I tell my children, I have two children, one 10 and 12, and I said, never miss the opportunity to do something creative. You know, never miss the opportunity because it's always there and whatever you do. And I love what you say about the, you know, embracing the business part because it's so important. It's like you have a certain value of how you live your life and there's stuff that you don't enjoy as much, but you have to embrace it with the same, you know, same passion. Otherwise, it your life is unbalanced, you know? Like I'm struggling something with our theater company about there's a value about being on time and early for rehearsals that doesn't transfer to being on time for company meetings. And I'm like, you can't have two values. You're either on time or you're not. That's my value, but it's not everybody's value. But it's just, you know, having, I just love the people I spend my time with, and I love the people I haven't met yet who are also passionate.
You guys, I can't thank you enough. It's so much fun. Thank you all for coming.
Yes, thank you.
Tomorrow, we will be on the stage and in the Paramount at 3 o'clock with two more companies.
Tomorrow?
I've lost the LAPD and
New York
City Players. So hopefully we'll see some of you tomorrow at 3 o'clock. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you all. Thank you so much.